I next have the pleasure to introduce Professor Margaret Hellard. Margaret is the Head of Centre for Population Health at the Burnet Institute and the Head of Hepatitis Services Infectious Disease Unit at the Alfred. Margaret is one of Australia's leading infectious disease epidemiologists with a significant national and international profile. Margaret is an infectious diseases physician and public health physician and has a PhD in infectious diseases epidemiology. Margaret's work has led to major new insights into the transmission and management of bloodborne viruses and sexually transmitted infections and how social networks influence disease transmission and risk behaviours. She has improved health practice through better clinical care and more targeted and informed prevention programs. Most recently, she has received funding to reduce hepatitis C transmission using a community-based social network approach. Margaret was also instrumental in the development of an innovative surveillance systems in Australia. She has over 150 peer-reviewed papers in the past 5 years. Very busy. So please make Margaret feel very welcome.
Thanks for that welcome, and thanks for the opportunity to come and talk about hepatitis C. PrEP will work, but it's incremental. I mean, we're going for incremental changes, treatment, PrEP, testing, all of them. Otherwise, we'll keep on going up. If you look at the 90-90-90 stuff, is my review, Martin, but I was just going to throw that in as a general comment as we go along. But today I'm talking about hepatitis C. So, and I was asked to talk about hepatitis C elimination strategies to enhance hepatitis C care and treatment in people who inject drugs. The simple thing I just want people to come away with today is that there's cure. We can stop people from dying of hepatitis C, we can stop the ongoing transmission of hepatitis C, and we can eliminate hepatitis C as a public health threat in Australia by 2030, possibly by 2026, and it's just a matter of figuring out in each area and each jurisdiction how we go about doing that. So I think that's basically, if you want to go away from today, from my talk with anything, just take that with you and work out how is it going to be done. It's each jurisdiction, because of the structure of the public health systems, the health service systems will be slightly different in that approach, but Australia is in a position to do it and do it ahead of most developed countries. Iceland is going to beat us. I'm on their technical advisory group for elimination of hepatitis C, and they're already nearly there. They've got three more cats left and a dog. No, a few others. They're nearly there. They only had to treat about 500 people. And Georgia, near Russia, has decided to eliminate, and they're aiming for 2020. And my thing to Australia is, are we really going to let Georgia beat us? Okay, I'm just saying, they have civil wars, they have poverty, they have stuff. We have a responsibility to show that proper health funded systems, and they also, the way they manage people and inject drugs can be appalling. They've been arresting them. So come on, let's not let Georgia beat us. I don't mind Iceland, but Georgia's just a step too far. So I have to disclose stuff, and importantly from the point of view of this particular presentation, I receive funding from Gilead Sciences, AbbVie and BMS to do investigator-initiated research, so I don't get that money and I don't do port talks for them except for free, because I, you know, but we do get funded for those, but we're allowed to write what we like. So the overview of today's presentation is overview of Hep C and the WHO elimination targets that were just released with the World Health Assembly just over a week ago. So there's elimination targets for hepatitis B and C. I've been asked to speak on C today, but let's not forget B, and that's entirely doable too. But I'm happy to take questions on B or HIV or actually anything later, but allegedly C. The new medications, the direct acting antivirals, just to make sure people are up to date. Why Australia can eliminate hepatitis C by 2030, but let's aim for 2026 because it's 10 years and it sounds good. And what we need to do if we're going to actually do that, including strategies to increase access to care for people who inject drugs, because that's a really important thing in terms of Australia. It varies across the world globally as to what you need to do to reach your elimination targets. But in Australia, hepatitis C transmission, new infections, are driven predominantly by people who inject drugs. So if you think about how does one stop an epidemic, you work on where in your area, your region, the epidemic is being transmitted. So for us, we need to focus in terms of transmission on people who inject drugs. To stop people dying from hepatitis C, we need to think about everybody who has been infected in the past through whatever means, and that may have been a history of injecting drug use, contaminated blood product, whatever it may be. But in terms of transmission, if we're to reach the targets, we need to do that. Basically, hepatitis C is really common. It's an estimated to between 110 and 130 million people are infected globally. As I say,
So far I've worked out the best way to reduce hepatitis C globally is to a different modeller to do it, and so the numbers have come down from around 180 to 150 to 110 and 130 in the last 5 years simply by modelling alone. So that's a very efficient way to get rid of hepatitis C. And I shouldn't be cynical because I do a lot of modelling, but I just like to put it there. You have to be, you know, constantly on your guard when it comes to models. Why do we give a toss is the other thing that you always have to think about with any infection. So basically somebody gets infected with hepatitis C, you get acute hep C. Most people don't have any dramas with it whatsoever. Some people just get rid of it, they clear spontaneously, but the vast majority of people go on to have ongoing infection, of which over a period of time, 10 to 20 years, depending on various things, you then begin to get liver disease. Now, not everybody goes on and gets sick with it, but some people do, and then they can get decompensated liver disease, hepatocellular carcinoma, and you can die. The issue is that if I got infected with hepatitis C today, I can't tell me, since I'm the clinician, I can't tell myself whether I'm going to be that person that progresses or that person that doesn't progress. You've got about a 1 in 10 chance of dying of your hepatitis C, but don't worry about it. Has been sort of the attitude, and I think we've got to stop that attitude of how would we actually feel of that, oh, well, you possibly won't go on and get sick. And that's been what we've had to deal with, but that's also because we've had crap medication, but it's all changing, and that's why it's really important when we think about this to not say, oh, let's wait and see who gets here. Am I being really unhelpful to the camera guy by moving around? Sorry, mate. but actually say, let's treat early, and also because of stopping transmission. So, lots of people die from it. And so this is a significant number of people are dying from viral hepatitis, B and C combined. And it's in fact more now in the United States, and it's going to be more in the next few years than people who die from HIV related deaths. And the burden of disease is about to come upon us. Because of where the epidemic started, most places in the world, we're about to be hit by people with this significant liver disease. This comes obviously, if you want to be a kind and compassionate person, it's people dying. If you want to be a health economist, it's stacks of money. Either way, it stacks up to do something about it. And as I said, for Australia, so I've got this slide, but also in many regions throughout the world, the epidemic is driven by the ongoing transmission through unsafe injecting drug use. It's really simple to fix. Just make sure that people have access to clean needles and syringes, opiate substitution therapy, but vast numbers of places throughout the world don't do that, and we don't get full coverage even in a place like Australia where we're not too bad. So some other countries, their epidemics are driven slightly differently, but I won't go into that today. So the Sustainable Development Goals, which are we had the Millennium Development Goals, and these Sustainable Development Goals that got passed late last year for the first time, said that basically viral hepatitis was named. We weren't going to end the epidemics, which was a bit of a disappointment, but at least we were going to combat the epidemic, whatever that meant. But we decided, I mean, a number of us decided, well, we were going to take that as end the epidemic. So, and basically elimination targets, as I said, have been set. So it's basically, it's part of these, that there are now 2030 targets for HIV, tuberculosis, malaria, and also now for viral hepatitis. And importantly, I think, if we think about the Millennium Development Goals, is also this concept of universal coverage and that basically health equity. And I think we need to also be thinking about all of what we're doing in that framework of health equity and the Sustainable Development Goals. Basically, good health leads to good outcomes for communities in terms of all sorts of things. So it's not just, So WHO had set the vision, a world where viral hepatitis transmission is stopped and everyone living with hepatitis has access to safe, affordable and effective healthcare. And as I said, the elimination targets have been set. I was fortunate to be on the working group or the advisory group that sort of was doing the discussion about what these elimination targets should be in late 2014. And I'm not saying they're not ambitious, but they are achievable. And it's really a matter of going, how do we go about doing that? And what we're talking about is not absolutely eliminated in terms of a true epidemiological word, but eliminated as a public health threat. So I think when you look at the HIV targets and the 90-90-90 and the 95-95-95 malaria TB, they're not really getting rid of the disease in terms of what we call true elimination or eradication as a public health threat. And what we're talking about is a decline in new infections by 80%. Overall for hepatitis it's 90%, but for hep C it's 80%, for hep B it's 95%. And basically a decline in deaths, so a 65% reduction in deaths related to hepatitis C. Now, in my view, Australia should just absolutely aim for that much more than that, but because we're in a privileged situation. But that's what the global targets are, and I think we can obtain those, and I think we can do it by 2026. To do this, 90% of chronic infections diagnosed, and so that's really important. And this concept of why one needs to diagnose, and it's the same thing with HIV in my view, one of the really important reasons to diagnose a disease is so somebody can make good choices for themselves about what they want to do about it. So that's the first thing, it gives somebody in my view empowerment is to make a choice as to how they want to manage their health. That may lead to a change in behaviour, it may lead to in hepatitis C they stop drinking even if they don't have access to treatments in a particular country. It can mean all sorts of things as to how they go about doing things. Or in a place like Australia, it empowers them to be able to seek out treatment. So we need to be making sure people can be diagnosed. Basically then the next one is that people get treated and that there is harm reduction. And I think that's a really important thing to understand. It's like all things with these diseases, you can have treatments as prevention, you can have however you want to be calling it, cure as prevention, whatever the word is, but people have to, number one, know to get onto them and understand that harm reduction is really effective. And it has been shown to be very effective in viral hepatitis and hepatitis C. And it's slightly different to, in my view, the issue of condoms and HIV. And the way I just put it really simply is the preferred position when one has sex is to not use a condom. Like, if you were given your druthers, you wouldn't use a condom. I mean, that's just as simple as that, and most of us in this room would know that and agree with that. So that means you're asking for a behaviour change to something that's less pleasurable. If you think about injecting, a punter wants a clean needle and syringe, and it's got nothing to do with the bloodborne virus. It's their veins. The vein is sacred. That's how you get drugs into yourself. And so for them, a sharp, shiny, new syringe, fine bore, is their friend, and they want it if they can get it. And it's not like they're doing us a public health service or anything like that. But what I'm saying is the preferred position or choice on the in behaviour that is being engaged with is to actually use a clean needle and syringe, and it's our job to provide it to them in ways that it's easily accessible all the time, 100% coverage, which we don't do. So that's why in terms of the behaviour change, we're actually not asking them to change a behaviour. We're actually, they would like to have the behaviour, please. Would you let us do it? So I think that's just a slightly sort of why I think we just need to think about it a little differently when I get asked those two things, because I mean, when I look at the HIV data and some of our struggles we'll get even when we reach the 1990 targets, the 1995 targets, and what's happening in Australia and some countries as to whether we'll actually get what we want, which is that reduction in HIV, we'll be able to do it in slightly different ways for hepatitis C. So, and this is one of the other big things, is direct acting antivirals are simpler, safer and more effective. We have cure. It's here and it's available. Now, I put this up because I like to sort of, because I also do some basic science, not so much anymore, but I used to sort of do a little bit, and I'm an infectious diseases physician, but basically just so that I look intelligent and go, these drugs work at all sorts of different places as the virus comes in. So it's a very similar to what happens with HIV, where basically the way you can kill a virus, some bugs are just tricky, like some bugs you can just slam an antibiotic at it, acts in a particular way, stops it from replicating dead because it does something to its cell wall or whatever. Viruses are trickier because of the way they integrate into a person. So often you have to use a combination of drugs that impacts on the way the virus takes up the machinery of the cell to kill it. And so that's just the simple explanation to say that the virus, the way we're killing it is by acting on a series of different places. One of them is as it's basically coming into the membrane and sort of what we call these protease inhibitors, and as it's beginning to sort of set up to replicate. One of it is further along in terms of how it sort of integrates itself into the genetic materials. And the other is sort of similar in that. And so you've got these NS, sort of basically the proteases, you'll hear about NS5Bs and NS5As. This combination of medications, generally there's just two, unlike with HIV where you need sometimes three, sometimes more, are highly potent and highly effective. And what I've got, the ones that have been named, are the ones that are essentially available in Australia at the moment or about to be. And they're really good drugs with minimal side effects. This is the big news. Basically, the federal government, whichever flavour of politics you like, you have to say this was a really great decision for the country. By a conservative government, and knowing what they were doing. There was a lot of talk in the 2 years beforehand with PVAC as to whether these treatments should just be made available for people with really severe liver disease, stage 3-4 liver disease, or whether they should be made available to everybody. And a lot of work was undertaken by people from community, by some of the people in the public health and medical sphere, and not all of the people in the medical sphere as to who should get access. So some of my colleagues would say, oh, look, it's very expensive, because these drugs, when they came onto the market, were very expensive. $1,000 a pill for Harvoni, so it was $80,000, $90,000 a course. Now, that was a garbage price. It was set there so that, like what I would say is at the beginning of an ambit claim or a negotiation. And some people did pay that full price, but even in the United States, most people were not paying that full price. It was the beginning of a negotiation with the drug companies as to what these medications should cost, because you knew their manufacture was much less. What you also knew is, though, that the companies quite reasonably had spent enormous amounts of money in developing some of these products. So somewhere in between lay the truth. And what was the responsibility of developed countries like Australia in terms of what we should pay? And what was the responsibility of the companies and us to pay so that resource-limited countries, like with HIV, get the generics? So we knew from the very beginning that this was going to be a negotiation, and how fast could that negotiation happen across jurisdictions to get prices to where they needed to be. And I think the really great decision by our government, so some people said it was too expensive, but there was a lot of push, and some of us were really strong on it, that you basically, if we wanted to eliminate hepatitis C as a public health threat, to just treat 3s, 4s would stop deaths, but we would not stop transmission, because people who are transmitting the virus most likely only recently infected, and so we would have no impact there. And that if we wanted to actually eliminate, stop transmission, we needed to be providing treatment to everybody, in particular focusing on people who injected drugs. So you need to treat up here to stop the deaths, but if we want to treat down here to stop transmission, it was going to have to be everyone. And I thought the federal government, so number one, PBAC did a fantastic negotiation, but the federal government, in this decision to make it available to everybody from March 1st, has made it totally possible for us to eliminate, and they should be commended on that decision, because there's not a lot of votes in providing treatment and high quality healthcare for people who inject drugs. It's not their constituency, and they're not going to be complimented, so I will compliment them on this decision. So the new treatments, basically the ones that were listed that were available to us were Declinza, Ledipivir and Sofosbuvir, which combined is called Harvoni, another drug called Sovaldi, and then there's been some recent listings of Viqirapac as well. Who can prescribe? Now, this was the other really important thing that we have to understand with this decision. Everybody can prescribe them. All doctors, primary care practitioners included. They have to do this thing called in consult, but that can be made as simple as possible. But basically, they're available for prescription for everybody, which I think is really important. They're accessible to all patients with chronic hepatitis C. There were no restrictions here. And treatment for each patient depends on the patient's genotype, serotic state, and the previous treatment, and it includes prisoners. And this was a deliberate decision, and again, it was a decision where the discussion, it's one of those really unusual cases where there's both what they call an S85 and an S100 listing. And the S100 listing was deliberately done through discussion so that, because the government were aware that if we wanted to treat prisoners, we needed to be S100, because you're not allowed to do Medicare into the prisons with an S85. So they were actually had this in mind. They weren't doing this accidentally. These decisions were not being made accidentally. There was a clear plan about it as to what we should be doing. And so my view is that we have a responsibility to take up the challenge that was set to us to treat as much as possible and to break the cap. So what's the cost for people? Because I'll explain the cap in a moment. Not much. It's just a standard thing. So I think we have to keep that in mind. As I said, I think it's really important to understand that was a clear decision was made around that S100 things for access. So the negotiation, PBAC did a fantastic job for Australia. So basically, nobody knows the exact what happened, but we sort of know. And essentially for Australia, the government said, I think it was $1 billion over 5 years, so it's about $200 million a year. And we know that essentially we're allowed to, the companies get a certain amount of money, and we think the cap is around the $10,000 to $12,000. So we think it probably costs around $18,000 to $20,000 a course, give or take. So down from Australia. So that's a really good price for the medications, but that's not just the thing. Once we've reached the cap of prescribing a certain number, say it was 10,000 scripts in the year, and keep in mind that up until these DAAs come onto the market, we've only been prescribing a couple of thousand a year, the company then takes over the risk. And we're not exactly sure how the companies take over the risk, but essentially we get it for free. So once we've reached a certain number of scripts in Australia, the companies get $200 million between them a year, in an argy-bargy negotiation that went on between the companies, and some of them were holding out because they were a little pissed, but it eventually happened. So essentially, once once 200 million has been spent, we just keep prescribing. So our job as clinicians, our jobs as nurses, our jobs as public health people is to set up systems to break the cap every year and to take the government's generosity to us and do it right so that we reach these elimination targets. So I think it's really important. And basically, this is the slide that Greg Dorr has loaned me, Greg, at the Kirby, where it's essentially saying we're already beginning to do this. So if you think in the last couple of years in Australia, we've been treating between 2,000 to 3,000 people a year. Now, partly we were warehousing, and I'll say that myself. Like, if I had somebody that, you know, was a stage one or two, I'd say, hang on, I've got something better for you. You were treating your threes, fours, or trying to put them into trials. But, you know, maybe at our maximum we're treating 3,000 people a year. We've already treated probably, scripts have been written for probably over 12,000 people in Australia already. We're not exactly sure because there's a lag in how you count it. In total, probably in Australia, 25 to 30,000, it's always hard to know how many people have ever been treated for hepatitis C. If we keep on going like we're doing, we might actually treat that many people in 1 year in Australia, but if nothing else, we have to be aiming 15,000 plus a year. My view is 20,000. Greg, I think, says 24 to 25. I'm happy to split the difference. So, you know, we should be aiming for it, though. So treatment works. This is the next thing I think you have to understand. It's not very often in a time in medical health, science, public health, you get to witness amazing things. I was fortunate enough as a HIV clinician to see 1996, when all my patients who died of HIV, and they did, they all were dying, then live. And people that I was seeing in 1996, I came back from maternity leave, and the highly active antiretrovirals had come in. And I remember the first patient I saw at clinic, and my first outpatients that morning, it was this guy, I'd never seen him before, and I thought, oh my God, he was just looking shocking. And I can remember admitting him to hospital and thinking I was never gonna see him again. I still see that guy now. He's well and alive because heart, the active retrovirals, it changed HIV. And I lived through that, and I'm fortunate enough to live through this. This doesn't happen very often, where you get a chronic disease of any type, including an infectious disease, where you get 95% plus cure of all of the different types. This is extraordinary. And again, we have, so that's why we have to exploit it. It's extraordinary for all of them, depending on their genotype. It's also, importantly, works for HIV. So previously, when we had people who were co-infected with HIV, we had crappy medications of it was around 50% cure rate, significant side effects with pegylated interferon and ribavirin. And then when we added baseprevir and telaprevir to try get our outcomes going up to 70% was marvellous, but I gave some of the people the best rashes I've ever given in my life. Like, you could really do dreadful things to people. It was horrible. Whereas these have minimal side effects. And with HIV, as I said, we were lucky to get to 50% cure. So even with HIV, if you're co-infected, still get brilliant cure rates. And people say, yeah, but will this happen in the real world? So when we get to the real world situation, so in countries where they have got the real world happening, this is what's happening, okay? So basically, just out in the community, you're still getting over 95%. So I think we can be really confident that even when we just, not outside of a clinical trial, but treating people with these medications, we can be doing it successfully. Also, we're about to have even better things come down the track. So at the moment, if you're not really aware of hepatitis C, there's different genotypes. Because in medicine, we're so, you know, kind of imaginative, we've got hepatitis A, B, C, D, E, F. Actually, there's not an F, and then G, three. And for, then within it, we basically then are even more imaginative, we enable them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So basically, in terms of the genotypes, we got up to 6. And at the moment, you have to, depending on a person's genotype, change the medication around slightly depending on a person's genotype. And I'm not going into all of the details today because I figure you can either look it up or you can ask me afterwards. But the pangenotypics are coming. This is what we call them, pangenotypics. And the ones that will first get to Australia are made by Gilead, which is sofosbuvir and velpatasvir, amazing drugs. A single tablet taken once a day for 8 to 12 weeks, regardless of the type of hepatitis C you've got, gives you this outcome. It's extraordinary. The other drug companies are coming with also some fabulous pangenotypics, so it won't be just these guys alone. So just, but I just want to sort of, this is the group that they're, as I said, these will probably come to Australia late next year, once they've been through FDA. But there'll be others. There'll be a range of drugs we've got to choose, pangenotypic, one tablet. Doesn't matter, it's just very, very simple. And they work also with people who have cirrhosis and are treatment experienced as well. So it's not there will be some people we will get stuck with, but the vast majority of people we will be able to treat, regardless of whether they've got significant liver disease, whether or not they've been previously treated with these medications. It's an extraordinary business. So why can Australia eliminate hepatitis C? Well, that's our weapon. It's one of our weapons. Our other weapon is clean, shiny syringes for people that want them. Okay, so if you think about what we've got, an opiate substitution therapy, there's really clear evidence that if somebody wants opiate substitution therapy, not only does it reduce their injecting risk behaviours, but also it reduces hepatitis C incidence. So three really good papers have come out in the last 12 months to 2 years to show that. So we've got weapons. We've got prevention weapons. We've got treatment weapons. We need to do some other things. We need to use our weapons. So that's going to be the trick. So why can we eliminate? Basically, really lovely modelling by Peter Vickerman and Natasha Martin from the London School of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene, but now at Bristol University, and now Natasha's across in University of San Diego, basically showed us in a very simple model, so I'm not going to go into the details because it's simple, but not simple, it's that kind of thing that Richard was talking about before, basically that if we treat people who inject drugs, don't have to treat everyone in one moment, that we can impact on hepatitis C prevalence. Depending on your background prevalence in your population, and this is sort of Australia, we sort of sit between 40 to 50%. If you treat 5, 10, 20 or 40 people who inject drugs per 1,000 annually, you can have a significant reduction in disease prevalence. You didn't have to treat everybody immediately. And this was with the old drugs. So then we did work with Peter and Natasha and others and looked at Melbourne, where we had data, because I follow cohorts of people who inject drugs in the community and do network studies and the like. And what we showed is basically if we scaled this up, the impact we could have by providing treatment to 40 to 80. So basically, this is the kind of reduction in prevalence we can have if we treat 80 per 1,000 people who inject drugs annually. You don't have to treat everybody immediately, but you have to have a plan to treat. And with the new medications, why the heck wouldn't we be reckoning we should be able to do something like this if we put treatment in the right places? Now, this is Melbourne, but essentially this background population prevalence is the same in all of the major Australian cities. So if we think about what the prevalence is, so this is a very doable thing. I then do work on, so I follow cohorts of people who inject drugs. Most people don't inject drugs on their own. They inject with somebody. So it's basically, we set up a thing where we looked at the injecting network. It's the same when you think about really any behaviour. So I actually, not just with Hep C, but really have an interest in how disease transmits through populations, taking into account the relationships that people have. In my view, risk transmits. Like if you sort of think about, you know, the work done in the Framingham study, where even sort of like people who are overweight are more likely to hang out with people who are overweight, or people who begin to hang out with people who carry less weight lose weight. It's those, basically our friends, our social networks influence what we do and what becomes of us. And the network, basically, we followed networks of people who injected drugs. Now, I could show you something really that fascinates me, which would bore you, but I won't. I'll cut to the chase. But essentially what our model showed is that if we thought about it in terms of how do we treat people, is there a complex way we think about where somebody is in the network and how many people they're connected with, and whether their network partners are positive or negative, and what's the rules? And I thought, well, as a clinician, I even don't even know how to begin to ask that question, and the person sitting in front of me is not going to know where they sit within their network. So essentially I sort of said to the modellers, can't we just ask them, you know, like about their friends, like a treat your friends approach? And so this one over here, oops, is rather than these sort of more complex ideas of network models, is simply said, if we treat their infected friends. So just a treat your friends approach. I treat you, and I can also treat their friends now. Now, once upon a time with the old drugs, PEG and ribavirin, you wouldn't do it because somebody was so pissed off and tetchy when they're on, you put them on medication, they'd have depression, anger, just feeling crap. So you would treat somebody, let things wash out, and then treat their partner or their brother or sister, whoever it was. With these new treatments, it's like write you a script, write your partner a script, you've got any relatives you want a script. It's really easy, okay? And because you can do this very, very simply. I mean, I do this all the time at the moment. It's great fun. It's like, you're just like, what do I did at clinic yesterday? I cured people. You know, so this is very simple. So now this treat your friends approach is a very simple way to do it. And what we showed in our models was that if you basically took this treat your friends approach, this is treating people randomly, but if we use a treat your friends approach, on top of what Natasha and Peter could see with their standard dynamic models of reducing that prevalence, we get even a bigger bang for our buck by taking a treat your friends approach. So by treating somebody and their partner at the same time who's hepatitis C infected, we can begin to even have a greater effect in elimination. And so there's some fancy modelling by Nick Scott, a guy who works in my group who's really, really good, is how I would summarise it. And essentially this is saying, this is what happens if we do jack, zip, nothing, we've got a problem, okay? And then we looked at if we just treated people who injected drugs or if we just treated people who had significant liver disease or did a combination of the both. And what we showed is if we just treated people who had that significant liver disease, we stopped the illness, we stopped the death, these, you know, decompensated liver disease and cancers and all of that. That was really good. But the prevalence of hepatitis C stayed up here. And this is treating basically 5,000-ish people a year. Now, we're gunning through that at the moment already. I already said we've written probably 12,000 scripts this year. But if you just think about that, what we're doing. Instead, if we go, well, we're going to do a combination of two things. We're going to treat about 5 to 10,000 people a year with a significant liver disease so we can stop these deaths. But if we just treated for Australia, when we worked out on average how many people inject drugs, just over 4,500 to 5,000, we can significantly reduce the prevalence of hepatitis C in Australia. So again, if we set our minds to this, we don't actually have to do much more than what we've got to be able to set ourselves on a path for elimination. The trouble is not enough people are being treated. As I said, one of our biggest problems is we lose people through the cascade of care. It's one of the really key things that basically when we think about what's going on in Australia, and this is work by Greg Dorr and others at the Kirby with input from people all around the country, is basically we've got this number of people, but there's not everybody's diagnosed. There's a significant fall off of somebody's being diagnosed where they know that they've got been exposed to hepatitis C, but only around 50% of people who have exposed to hepatitis C are aware that they've still got the virus in their blood, let alone going into receiving treatment and the like. And our job over the next couple of years is to change this cascade so it looks like this, okay? And there's no reason why we shouldn't be trying to do that. So what we need to do is we need to have everyone who's infected diagnosed, everyone diagnosed engaged in care, models of care that suit the affected populations, so it's not one size fits all. We need harm reduction, vaccine development, address stigma and discrimination, because that's one of the really big reasons why this hasn't been happening until now. And then we need workforce capacity to have that happen. And it's not that we have to necessarily spend more money. We just have to think about where the money is being spent. And basically in terms of what David Wilson in my group would call allocative efficiency go, does all that money need to be in the tertiary hospitals? Or after the next 5 years when we've treated the vast majority of people with significant liver disease, how much of that can move into the community and how much of that's moving into community care at the moment? So let's really think about the programs. I hope there's not too many hepatologists in the room. I mean, I'm doing myself out of a job. I work at a tertiary hospital too. So, but that's our job, is to do ourselves out of a job. We've got to start to think that everybody that arrives at our hospital after the first couple of years is a testament to our failures as opposed to our successes now that we have these treatments available to us. And if we don't start to think about that, and to me with HIV, anybody that actually sees me who's sick in hospital related to their HIV, in my view is something that reflects our failures rather than our successes in the health system. And I think if we think about it in those ways, we may get somewhere. So it's predicated on a vital thing in Australia. You have to treat people who inject drugs for the reasons I've talked about. I've said that we're basically not bad at diagnosing, so that's the key, but we're not so great at treating. We do need to increase testing. And similar to what Martin was talking about, there are really good point of care tests becoming available. And we have to think about how we utilise these to make sure that anybody who is at risk of hepatitis C is offered a test. And whether that means then we have to follow up with formal testing to fit the guidelines. But in fact, I've just finished chairing the WHO guidelines, the first guidelines to do with viral hepatitis testing. Globally, we will be talking about single testing because there's a clear recognition that although you worry about false negatives and false positives, your biggest problem globally is that a whole lot of people are dying because they've never been tested. So we have to have guidelines that actually reflect that as opposed to that small proportion of people where you may get a false positive or negative, but also have systems in place to be dealing with that. So I think also in Australia we have to be thinking about that if we want to achieve these targets and how do we have systems set up to achieve this. We have to be able to measure And at the moment, a FibroScan is how you measure disease fibrosis, and that is important because it makes a difference as to the decision of what treatment somebody goes on if they've got cirrhosis or not. But also there's really simple ways to measure fibrosis in some people with a thing called an APRI score, which is an inexpensive thing, and in the WHO guidelines for testing, care and treatment, they talked about using an APRI for a resource-limited countries. But I would argue, why wouldn't we use an APRI in a country like Australia, where if we have a conservative approach to the APRI, and say if your APRI is less than, say, 1 or less than 0.8, we can have a look at positive and negative predictive values, you definitely don't have cirrhosis, so you don't need a FibroScan. And that'll account for about 50 to 60% of the people in the population, which means that only another 40% need to go on to have the FibroScan to be more specific about your level of disease. And so that means that in communities where you have limited access to a FibroScan, you can basically go, okay, I don't have to have a FibroScan for everyone. So we need to be really thinking about these things and not getting stuck in really what I'll call conservative mindsets around how we have to do this and say, well, actually 60% of the population doesn't need it. 40% does, and we need to be precise. But that's a lot less people having to wait for a FibroScan. We need, no one model of care fits, to me there's not one model. We need to have multiple models. And but before I do that, I'm going to dispel a quick couple of myths, which I don't think I need to for this room, but I'm going to anyway. Basically, people who inject drugs don't want treatment. Garbage, they do. Treatment outcomes for people who inject drugs with hepatitis C are no good and much worse than people who don't. I kept on being told this by my colleagues, and that in fact I did this piece of work when I was told by one colleague that I was negligent at a court forum for doing what I was doing. I thought, I'm not sure I'm so negligent. I could be negligent. I better check. So I checked, and she was wrong. So we did a review. Essentially, people who inject drugs do well and can be treated for hepatitis C. This is an old piece of work, but a good piece of work because it was the first piece of work that changed this, and it was, this is in the WHO guidelines. Systematic review, treatment outcomes, followed up just because some of them didn't like to believe it once. We had to do it a few times for them and had to get some more data, and it kept, and it's basically saying the same thing. Treatment completion, people who inject drugs are crap at taking drugs, and they won't, they're very good at taking drugs and they do complete treatment. So now they say, well, that was when there was the old drugs, because you were poisoning them and making their life really, really difficult. That's the reason they stuck by it, and then they were good, and they won't take the new drugs because it's too easy for them. It's like, no joke, that was at a conference. It's not very often at a conference I stand up and go, oh, look, man, I'm just going to have to make a comment, because sometimes I just can't be bothered. I just thought, but this time I thought, can I just clarify your logic? You know, so they're basically, but guess what? Even with the limited number of studies we've got of the new drugs, they're very good at it still. So, I mean, it's just this constant garbage. The other thing that we get cold is that they will reinfect, and I'm going to come back to that, okay? Because reinfection happens. But I'll come back to that and talk to that in a moment. But guess what? Even when they were taking drugs, in this study, Greg Dorr has given me this slide, so he led the co-star study, we recruited into it. But basically, even when they're taking drugs, people who inject drugs also took their medication and were cured. And their adherence, oh, funny thing, was really good as well. So people who inject drugs or people who drink alcohol can't be treated for the hepatitis C because that treatment won't work. I hear this all the time. Wrong again. You can drink alcohol. The issue with alcohol is if you drink too much alcohol, it causes your liver disease to advance. But, well, wouldn't I want to treat the hepatitis C because it's like two naughty kids in school anyway? The issue with alcohol is whether or not you remember to take your medication. So somebody who's got lots and lots of alcohol on board, it's a compliance issue. But the actual alcohol during treatment doesn't make the drugs not work. Okay, so those kind of really confused stories about alcohol and not treating somebody for hepatitis C are based on a poor understanding of the literature is how I would put it to people, and we need to keep that in mind. No evidence that occasional injecting has any effective chances of treatment success. Regular injecting daily or every second. One study found that may make people less likely to complete treatment. No difference was observed in SVRs. Numbers are small. All of the evidence suggests we can do this, okay? So I think that's the thing to be mindful of. Reinfection, as I said, I'm going to come to that again in a moment, but is a potential issue. Models of care, essentially community. I mean, where do most people want to be treated? Most people want to be treated in community, and the evidence would suggest that you do not need to go and see a fancy doctor like me to take a tablet a day if you're not that sick. Okay, so again, randomised trial measuring the impact of nurse education. Nurse education works in terms of treatment uptake. work in Scotland with the hepatitis C plan, and the action plan has again shown that if you take treatment out into the community and treat people who inject drugs, treatment is effective and you get better uptake of treatment. Current models of care in Australia basically are suggesting this is the case. We don't have what I would call like high quality randomised controlled data. We're getting some, but nurse-led models of care to be effective. Victoria's had 10 community nurses funded by the Victorian government for the last number of years, and basically the idea was that those nurses were meant to be at the tertiary hospital and work in community. I'd say some tertiary hospitals use those nurses as they were meant to, and the other way I was explaining is others didn't. But in those that did, including my hospital, basically it worked really well and in our view was setting up into the future in terms of what we should be doing. And we had a nurse who would basically come from our hospital, but she would go out into these three high caseload communities where there's lots of people who inject drugs, would see the people. I would go down, I mean, I do a community-based clinic once a fortnight, but I actually don't think I'll need to go anymore or as often anymore with the new treatments. It's so easy. We have clinicians doing that, but essentially what we were able to show, and even though this doesn't look great, this was with the old drugs, is our engagement in care. I don't know whether you remember that last cascade drop down like that, where we were able to actually engage people in care. Now, the new treatments, we were warehousing, so we didn't have as many people on treatments, but basically at the moment we're going like this in terms of our numbers, but the idea is still to get it like that, as I said, for those cascades of care. In WA, there's been some really nice work around telehealth and also work with remote communities, thank you, as well. So I think there's sort of lots of really exciting things done here. And I just think what we have to do though, and I don't know enough about the sort of WA setup, but to me it's a bit like what I'll be arguing for Victoria, is it has to be cohesive in terms of the response. So you've got bits and pieces of stuff going on, and what we're trying to set up over the next 6 months in Victoria is what I'd call a really cohesive response to how we actually get treatment. So the tertiary hospitals, we can be treating our sick patients and curing those. And then we have to be setting up a cohesive response in terms of community as to how do we upscale the number of people being treated in community. There's, as I said, lots of different models. Ethos, work by Jason Grebley up in New South Wales, has again shown that people, if you provide care in the community, you get high levels of engagement from people who inject drugs. So my summary is that that works. Some current research. I'm running out of time, she gave me a 5 minute signal. My summary, so a couple of studies. I just wanted to tell you about the TAP study, which is a study that we're doing of a community-based study measuring the impact of hepatitis C treatment in the community. And basically what we're looking at is whether or not that networks-based approach that I talked about, so not only do we treat the person but their friends, or we just treat the person and not their friends, or we had this arm but we're actually having to get rid of it because of the treatments becoming available at PBS kind of ruined this arm of the study, so we're getting rid of that, but really looking at the impact of your friends approach. But also that study is basically a nurse in a van with her FibroScan machine and community outreach workers, and it's only a paper check by a doctor, so basically only being seen by nurses out in the community, and these are the most complex people who inject drugs, so they're not even engaged in clinics and clinical care. The PRIME study is a randomised controlled study in those primary health care services that we have in Victoria, where basically the person comes in and can see somebody and then they get randomised to have their full care, including their FibroScan and all their treatment, in the community clinic, or they get randomised to go up to the tertiary hospital. And essentially we start looking at treatment outcomes but also retention into care, because we still have this pushback about where treatment should occur. And as much as my view is the data would clearly suggest that treatment can occur in community, this is a randomised control trial, not just for Australia but for other places as well, to look at the difference and whether or not there is any difference in treatment outcomes and retention into care. Basically it's to say, although it makes common sense, it's that kind of thing of where it makes common sense and the data available suggests this direction, you still get this incredible pushback from certain sectors about where treatment should be happening. The work I'm, even in Georgia where they're doing this elimination program, you've got these people that really are pushing back who are centrally in charge and you know, in positions of power, and there's lots of reasons for why people do that, of saying now all the treatment has to be at a tertiary hospital centre. So this study is not just for Australia but for a number of places globally. There's the Stop C study, which is being done by Andrew Lloyd up in New South Wales and with Greg Dorr and Jason Grebley, and this is looking at basically treatment programs in prisons, because you know, if you think about it again, prisons, people stay in prison for 6 to 8 months on average, so if we can with these new treatments provide care, because then they're back out in the community, we can impact on transmission. Alex Thompson's doing a similarly really interesting program in Victoria. The COESI study is about eliminating hepatitis C transmission and care amongst HIV-HCV co-infected people in Melbourne. Essentially, we're just going to try and treat everybody who is co-infected. It's not that hard. No, it is a little bit, but essentially the rationale is if we get the DAAs to everybody, we can, again, impact on transmission through our models. The study design is basically anybody that's going to a high caseload service, be that in primary care or tertiary hospital, gets enrolled in, and we're following along to see whether or not we impact. I think to have disappeared a slide from this. But essentially, if you sort of think about it, in terms of this 10,000 gay and bisexual men probably in Victoria who are HIV infected, there's a proportion that are co-infected, and essentially what we're doing is aiming to treat that sort of, it's about 1,000 gay and bisexual men who are hepatitis C co-infected. And we figure if we can basically treat a huge number of those, a significant proportion of those, in the next 2 years, then the number that are infected are really low. So it's a really then simple thing to keep that at a management level, because what you've got is your disease prevalence really back down to being very low in that population. I want to just put a plug for this, and it's because it's sort of a little bit already in Western Australia, but it's also, which I'm happy to talk about, the access surveillance system, which we've had with Rebecca Guy, have been managing, it's set up and managing, which is basically a bloodborne virus and STI surveillance system. Initially started off with chlamydia. It was national. Then funding was sort of cut back on it, and it was then funded by the Victorian government and the New South Wales government, a little bit by Northern Territory and ACT. And basically it's a system where we monitor hepatitis, so bloodborne virus, HIV, hepatitis and STI testing at a laboratory level, and also at high caseload levels and sexual health clinic levels as well. So we can look at not just test outcome, like a passive surveillance system, but testing and look at the cascades of care. We've just heard that the federal government is going to fund us to allow us to do this nationally, so we will be able to extend it back to Western Australia, because they were originally involved in the original access with chlamydia, so I'll be having a conversation with you about this very shortly. But this is a really exciting thing, because it allows us then to monitor the impact of our elimination programs, be it for HIV, for viral hepatitis, hepatitis C or hepatitis B. So I think it's a really thing that ticks along in the background with other parts of the surveillance system, but this is just one of the things that can help us evaluate our success. Reinfection happens. I wanted to say that. In non-treatment cohorts, it's probably over 20%. In post-treatment, the data's not really clear in the real world, but it's probably between 5 and 10%. It's really simple. What do you do about reinfection? You retreat, okay? Because it benefits the individual and it benefits their networks. If you think about it, if somebody has been treated and they come back in and are reinfected, that's the perfect person to treat because they're the transmitter. So you retreat, okay? It's not very hard. And you retreat again and again. But when you've done it for the third time, ask yourself this question. Are you stupid? Did you not give them needle and syringe syringes to take with them? Did you not provide them with education? And did you not provide, what did you not do to make it that your patient doesn't actually get access to clean needles and syringes? So when you retreat for the third time, ask yourself the question, did you do proper harm reduction? And I think the problem lies with us, with the retreatment, not with the person, okay? Because with rare exception, unless somebody has really got some major health issues in terms of the like, they don't want to get reinfected. They're in a position where that happens. So it's really simple. If a person is reinfected, retreat. And I would just simply say there are a few other diseases I can think of anywhere where we would not have this attitude. I'm sorry, you can't have that second lot of CAGs because I went and looked in your refrigerator and you had hard cheese. I'm serious, like, would we do that? No, you just laughed. Diabetes, I'm sorry, I'm not gonna give you another script for insulin. I saw you eat a donut. Of course we wouldn't do that. And yet we wanna do it. I'm sorry, we're not gonna retreat you because you've obviously injected drugs, because you're addicted to a drug that you're injecting. And we didn't give you clean needle syringes, we didn't offer you open substitution therapy, I'm not gonna treat you. Like, I'm sorry, why? And this comes out of something really important. A lack of high quality harm reduction, accessible, safe harm reduction. This is highly cost effective. It works. We need a vaccine as well. And it's to do with stigma and discrimination. And that's where it comes from. That stupid attitude about retreatment, that stupid attitude about provision of needle. There is clear evidence basis for the public health response to this. And we just keep on having a wrong attitude because some of us think it's icky. I'm not advocating for people to run out and inject drugs. personally, I think it would be just time intensive, and I'm just too lazy for that kind of business, if you think about it. But if somebody does, the appropriate public health response is not to go, oh, I think I won't treat you, I don't really want to do all of these things. It's just ridiculous. We've caused the problem. It's really clear about drug policy and what has and hasn't worked globally in places where things have worked, and I think we just need to reconsider it. Elimination is possible. What I say to people is treat the person in front of you or in front of your nurse or your primary care practitioner or your support or telehealth. Make sure you have a system in place of providing care that means all patients can be in front of you. I think that's a really important thing, particularly people who inject drugs. Set up systems to monitor testing, and don't forget harm reduction. Lots of people to acknowledge. Thanks.
That was brilliant, and thank you. And I think let's make the most of Margaret, because she's only here for today. So please put some questions to Margaret. Donna?
Margaret, I'm just wondering whether the value of using treatment and how effective are attitudes of some of the people in our prison system to allow having safe needles in prison, we don't think that's likely to happen.
If you're to talk about what I would call the evidence base, globally the evidence base is clearly that we should have needle and syringe programs in our prisons. It is safer for the prisoners, it is safer for the staff. We have failed to be successful in getting that in. I think we should not stop trying to get that in, and I think every time we're writing national strategies, state strategies, I had the amusement once of being the writer of one of the national strategies of where I would write and needles and syringe program, and it would come back and they'd have taken it out, and they'd say, would you like to make a comment? Oh yeah, I think I'll make a comment. I'd put needles and syringe program back. I said, don't send it back to me again for comment if you take it out, because I can't say I agreed to your thing. So I think we have to push, we have to recognise the reality is we haven't got very far in the last 20 years. One day though, I have a lot of sports analogies, and one of them is I just say you're setting up for goal, like in soccer or in hockey. I was a hockey player, and you're basically waiting for a moment when the backs have split and you go through. And I'm still waiting for that moment. It will come, and we will get needle and syringe programs into a prison somewhere in Australia. We nearly got it into the Canberra prisons. And then we will show that it is safe, effective, nothing to be scared of. In the meantime, we just have to keep on maintaining our understanding that that's what's needed, as well as ensuring we have high quality treatment in the prisons. So go for our wins, but don't forget that that's one of the things we're going to eventually try to get.
Let's go to the gentleman beside Graham. I'll go across the room, if that's okay.
Thanks, Margaret. Michael from the Australian Federation of AIDS Organisations. I just wanted to pick up on what's been a theme, obviously, in Martin's and then yours about community-based and peer-based testing, and just what opportunities in relation to hepatitis C there is to replicate what's been done very successfully at the AIDS Council levels, and also what your opinion is on the likelihood that state governments will fund them as supportively as they have in a lot of states for HIV rapid testing.
Yeah. So I think, a little bit more the Victorian situation. So Victoria's funded the HIV one on the view that they thought that they were going to only have to fund it for a couple of years, and then it would be coming in through the MSAC, and it hasn't happened. So I would say there's not a strong appetite from the Victorian government at the moment to do it, or a lot of governments, because unless they can go, we can give this cost to the federal government, there's a reluctance, I think, is how I would put it, even though to me... So I think my view on this is we're about to start doing it anyway. There's some places in Victoria already doing a little bit of it, and we'll be doing some trials around it. And I know that, say, up in Sydney, Jason Grebley and Greg and those guys, Greg Dora, are doing some work on it, because there are some really good point-of-care tests, oral finger for antibody, and then the point-of-care tests, the Cepheid tests for RNA testing, are very, very good. And they are going to be, they're here in part, and they're being evaluated. So we're going to have the machinery to do it. So then what we have to be able to show is this effective, is this cost effective, is this cost saving? And so I think our next job is to help provide the evidence for that whilst we try to get it in and do feasibility studies as well. So to me also one of the things is, what's the feasibility of this? How do we get say to me, I was literally having this discussion yesterday at the primary healthcare service that I go to for community-based treatment with them about, you know, if somebody's coming in and just coming in to pick up their needle and syringes and then wandering out, what's, you know, can we offer them a test at that moment? What would they take it? What proportion would take it? How do we actually just have the front desk, who are just basically peers and sort of people, provide the service? So yeah, so there's studies and it's being looked at. I think it'll come because it has to come. Because if we want to eliminate, and then we get cost savings. Because I think this is the other thing that we're going to find with hepatitis C care, is the number of people, when you're talking to them now, who had mild disease, inverted commas, but who feel better, are back at work, have more energy, all of those things, will be doing models around not just cost effectiveness, but cost savings to help the governments understand the benefits of this kind of thing. So I think it'll come. But we need work.
Fantastic presentation. Just to take a step back, what you were saying before, I share your optimistic views about making the final push of NSPs in prisons eventually, but until that happens, to what extent do you think that'll influence the eradication predictions that you told us about earlier? Do you think it's possible without NSPs in prison?
Yes, I do. Yeah. So in Victoria, as part of the response, the Department of Justice in Victoria has essentially funded treatment in the prisons in terms of the structure. The drugs are available, so they don't have to pay for the drugs. And so to me, it's a matter of going, what's your strategy for treating within the prison systems? And who do you treat in terms of significant disease? If somebody's only in for a short period of time, what's the handover and what's the mechanism of the handover to make sure that happens? But also, because the issue is going to be reinfection in the prison system, when people go into prison, they don't stop injecting, but they inject less frequently, but they inject far less safely. I mean, there's good data on that. So to me, it's a matter of going at the front end as somebody comes in to actually begin to treat them immediately. And so again, it's a matter of thinking about what are your systems and what are your structures, and is that a reasonable thing to be doing when somebody's got a whole lot of other stuff to be coping with? So we need to be doing work around it and what it looks like, but essentially we should be aiming for most of our prisons to be hepatitis C, pretty close to hepatitis C free, as opposed to the quite opposite thing that they are at the moment. There's no reason we can't get a long way along that track. You just have to be setting up. This becomes a health structure, so health services systems issue that we've got now with hepatitis C, as opposed to, as I said, we've got the tools. It's now how we're going to use the tools effectively. And engage community, because when I say effectively, it's not just a health service person going, this is how we're doing it. This is where really engaging community, working with community as well, is really important.
Sally from Hepatitis WA. I just had a question asked and I thought you'd probably be better up to answer it. When someone's actually on the treatment,
yep,
whether it's 8, 12 or 24 weeks, is that almost prophylactic as well?
As in, when does their virus go not detectable? Is that what you...
Yeah, well, if for reinfection, so if someone was in prison, they went on to the 12-week treatment,
yep,
and they clear the virus in the first couple of weeks, they get, yep, SBR or whatever.
Yes.
Is that then prophylactic?
Yeah, so probably, yes. If you look at it, there's not been well looked at, but if the question you're asking is, if I'm on treatment, what's the probability of a virus getting in? I was about to say something inappropriate. the camera's on. It's highly, highly unlikely. So yes, yes, it would be. I mean, I think it's not been well studied, but when you have looked at those kind of things of people on treatment, it's only when they come off treatment. But also there's genotype specific, so you would argue that at the moment, when we don't have pan-genotypics, you'd have to be mindful. I don't think it's the best way to do it. But yeah, if everybody in a prison was put onto hepatitis C treatment today, it'd be gone.
Maybe just one more question and then we might break for morning tea.
Can you remind me, I want to do an advert as well.
Okay.
Just in relation to the treatment regime, if clients aren't compliant with taking medications every day, is there any issues with resistance or anything like,
yeah,
that?
It's a really good question. The people that make the drugs say there's no evidence, this, da 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 da. I'm a skeptic. Of course, we'll have some resistance. Okay, there's some natural resistance to these viruses anyway, and when you roll them out into communities and they're really taken poorly, that will happen. The reality is, at the moment, though, we're not seeing it. But you know, give us time. It's a bit like, you know, once upon a time they said, I'm sure, you know, 1945, you know, there'll be no penicillin resistant. Ha. So yes, it would be my general comment. Yes, it will. So one of our things is, when people say to me, how do I choose who I treat? I do it a really, really simple way. And I learned this from a couple of studies where I tried to look at the data. We looked at the data this way and that way. It's really simple. A person comes to see me or see the nurse and said, I really want treatment. And you go, oh, okay, I've got to do this workup. And then you do the workup and they come back to their appointment and they say, I really want treatment. And you go, really? Oh, yeah, yeah. And so, and it's, if they come back, and often I used to be for three, and then I go, okay, come back and we'll go through it all with you. And when they come back the third time, I treat them. The only way I can judge is because they come back. And so to me, you can't judge, and I'll go through it, you can't judge on whether they're injecting at the time. You can't judge on their alcohol use at the time. You can't judge on their social circumstances at the time. You can't judge on anything that we can actually accurately measure at the time. Okay? Afterwards, you can go back and say, you're less likely, you're less likely. But to go back here when we looked at it and say, can I predict? We've found nothing yet to predict. So the judgment to me is on somebody comes back to their appointment and says, I want treatment. I then go through with them whether they may have difficulties. Have you got a house? Have you got a room that can lock, like if they're in a boarding home? Do you have it picking up with your method? What will work for you? And so my view is, it's simply you ask the person how they would like you to give them the treatment. And some of them want to have it at home. Some of them want to have it at their chemist. Some of them want to have it like whatever you like. Some of them want to come back and pick it up from that service. My view is ask somebody what they want. They generally know what's best for themselves and how they're going.
Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you, Mark. Are you going to
Can
add?
I just do a couple of things? The access system that I talked about, as I said, it's coming, and we're really interested in engaging with people from WA that are interested in that kind of stuff, because obviously, so some research around it and sort of WA-specific research, so just wanting to put that up as something. Also, I'd be really happy to talk to anybody. We're about to start, obviously, a program for elimination in Victoria, and I know that at the New South Wales, with talking with Greg, New South Wales be doing those kind of things, and we're really interested in collaboratively engaging with groups who would be interested in sort of what's possibility in Western Australia in terms of systems and services, and helping evaluate it or giving advice and those things, because to me, we have a real opportunity to eliminate viral hepatitis. We didn't, as I said, I didn't talk about Hep B. And so to me, it's a matter of working and saying, what can we be doing to help support those efforts? So if anybody's interested, more than happy to have a chat at morning tea or lunchtime.
Just one question on that. Given it's a national project, what do you think the likelihood of getting an Indigenous identifier on testing data is like? That's a big issue for WA.
Yeah, we had this conversation a few years ago about how do you make it get legislatively passed. I think we have to go back, and my view is I'm one of those really simple people, as I go back and ask again and again and again. I just think it should be part of a legislative requirement that it's there, and part of, for primary care practitioners and tertiary hospitals, the way they get paid money by the government. Well, I wouldn't pay them money until they get above a certain level of completion. Like, you know, that's nice, but, you know, you're getting sooky about your Medicare rebate, how much you get back? Well, you just lost 5% because you didn't have Indigenous status written on the form.
There's a lobbying point. Anyway,
I mean, I just don't understand. Yeah. I would also say cult. Mm. Like, you did not have these things written on the form. Mm. We need you to write them on the form because it's bigger than you as an individual doctor. Mm. I would be punitive.
Yes. Please thank you, Mark.